Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us for the Mastering Macroseismics and Geomechanics third webinar in the series. I am going to now turn you over to John Wei for your session. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy. Hello everyone. Welcome to the third webinar of this webinar series. My name is Jun Wei. My main responsibility at Image is software production, development, and also provide support to internal and external client. So the third webinar will be focusing on the data processing. If you remember the first webinar, we gave an overview of microseismic data processing and geomechanics modeling techniques, and we point out the usage of these techniques in unconventional oil and gas reservoir development, such as stimulation, completion design, well plan, and reservoir management. So in the following webinars of this webinar series, we'll be elaborate on the specific techniques and go through the entire workflow of data processing and geomechanical modelings. The previous webinar was focusing on the survey design, so I shared with you a few tips that you may use to maximize the coverage and also minimize the uncertainties. It's a very good exercise, actually, for you to understand your acquisition footprints before you start acquiring the data. So if you missed any of the previous webinars, you can visit our webpage, and there's a link to the recordings of this webinar. This webinar will be focusing on the data processing part, that including a project setup, and then run a detector through the data streams and look for triggers. You group the triggers into different type, and then you run a processing, either older processing or manual processing, and you pick the waveform and you get the catalog of the microseismic data. And the interpretation part that after this step actually relies heavily on the quality of the data processing results. So that makes this step a critical part in the entire workflow, and we dedicated two webinars to this tasks. This webinar will be focused on the fundamental part, and we have a follow-up webinar to talk about how to do the quality control and if there's any problems that you can diagnose from a processing results, if there are, and how we can fix them. So this webinar will be more focusing on the fundamental part of microseismic data scene. And there are two steps that we usually do when we start approaching raw data. One is data detection or data harvesting, and next one is data processing. The fundamental information that we go after are the time and the space. So basically, it's the microseismic catalog that we can get from the raw data. So here, just going to give you a quick overview of this presentation. I'll first give you go over some basic concepts to give a big picture of microseismic data processing. So the message is, what are we supposed to do in microseismic data processing? What are we, which direction we're heading? What's the purpose of doing that? Then I'll show you how to set up a project, how we do that internally, the geometry, the coordinate of everything, the well pass, the well head information, the well object, such as the perforation shots, or the plug and sleeve locations has to be in the right positions, and the geoform orientation has to be oriented in the right location. So the expected output from this step would be something like this. It's a 3D picture, and we have our boreholes, sonic lock, treatment well, perforation shot, either you planned or it really happened from the field. If you have stream shots, it should also be included in the picture. And more importantly, it should be verified from the client. And after that, we can start to touch the raw data, and we run data detectors. And there are multiple types of data detectors that go through your continuous data streams, and we're looking for triggers. For those ones that you know the time and location, so you can group them as shots, and we use that to calibrate the velocity and also orient the geoforms. The ones that is no signals in it, it could be categorized as noise, and you can use that to calibrate your network performance. So if you remember the previous webinar, your noise is dynamic, and you can use that information to calibrate your sensitivity. The microseismic events are the major players here. The first loop is usually go through automatic processing. So you either using the time inverse method or a source scanning method, a migration type of location method, and then you can also follow-up by a menu check. You can either check all of them or you just check a part of that depending on your time budget. So if you do decide to relocate some of the events, you may either need to repeat the travel time or reprocess the waveform and then get the locations. What we do usually after location is we also have some other information that automatically calculated at the same time, such as the source parameters, how big is the source radius, the stress drop, moment tensor, how the rock breaks, and those source parameter informations. And keep in mind that there are errors in the entire process. There will be errors in the velocity model, and there will be errors in the travel time, and also will be errors in the geoform orientations. And more interesting is there are errors actually in the project setup. Although you got all the information verified from the client, but there may be something that even the client are not aware of in the first place. For example, the geoform has been moved, but it's not well documented. So it's rare, but it does happen. So you have to keep that in mind when you when you're doing the data processing. So quality control is a very important step in this processing workflow. So this will be your expected output from this data processing step. You have dots in the box, but we don't end here. The next step is to do some quality control, reassess, reevaluate your processing qualities and see if there's some biases, uncertainties that in your processing results. And after that, you can hand that over to the interpretation. So our next webinars will be focusing on how to do the quality control and reprocessings. And after that, I'll draw some conclusions for this presentation. First of all, what is microseismic processing? What are we supposed to do and how we can locate events? So in this picture, I showed you two identical waveforms. So that's our real data from a shot like this. So this is your project that has been set up. You have sonic logs and you build a velocity model, layered model based on the sonic log. You have a shot of microseismic events here and recorded by 12 geophones right here. And that's your propagation path. If you can get the travel times, either the P wave travel time and the shear wave travel time, by the way, the geoforms are rotated into the ray coordinate. So you have the red for P wave, the black and blue for shear wave. You don't have shear wave splitting, so that's a good sign. And then the distance between the shot to your observation boreholes is controlled by the P wave and shear wave arrival time differences. The vertical depth is controlled by the move out for P wave. I only show the P wave. It's also controlled by the shear wave move out. So with these two constraints, you can start to locate the events in 2D. But in 3D, you need some additional constraints. You need to know where the energy comes from around the borehole case. So you need to do some polarization analysis or hologram analysis to understand which direction the energy comes from. So I have a slide to talk about a hologram analysis. And then we can do that for every single triggers that you get from the data streams. So you get a few clouds of microseismic events, and then you can start to do the interpretations. You can draw an envelope that's surrounding your microseismic cloud, and you can make some interpretations and indications about the stimulation performance or the rock integrities. For example, you can estimate the stimulated reservoir volume based on the cloud. So that's a big picture about microseismic data processing, how we can do that, and what's the purpose of doing that. To get there, the first step, of course, is the project setup. And I just take the appendix from Sean's book, published in 2014 by SEG. Appendix A give you a list of information that you need to gather. Really depends on your acquisition geometries. If you're using boreholes, there's information for borehole. And if you're doing surface monitoring or shallow well monitoring, and there's some specific informations you need. So lots of informations that you're supposed to gather to set up the project. Some of them are essential. Some of them are nice to have in order to quality control your processing results. I just want to point out a few things. The coordinate is important. As I first mentioned, the coordinate of everything, wellhead, the deviation, the perforation, the geophone location, the coordinate of those things are important. Also, the hydraulic fracturing schedules, so we know where to look for the perforation shots, where to look for the ball seating events, or even early microseismic events. We can use that to calibrate the velocity models. Sonic logs are also important, and some information that we at least have to build a velocity model based on that, and we have something to calibrate with. If you're doing surface monitoring, there is a specific problem associated with that is the static corrections, for example. So you may need to collect information such as surface topography, terrain, or the approximate depth to the bedrock, for example. So to gather those information involves lots of communication with the client. And one of the reasons is the information are usually scattered around and really depends on the type of organizations. For some organization, the information are more centralized, but for some other organizations, those information are probably spread across multiple teams. So you need lots of interaction and talk to the client to verify every single information you got. And it's actually very important because any mistakes or omissions that in this step will take more time and resources to correct in the following steps. And the worst situation is errors stay undiscovered and propagate into your interpretation. If that happens, that means your project will be concluded with significant biases in it. So we'll have a webinar talking about all kinds of biases. So you can stay tuned for those webinars. So here I just want to use a video to demonstrate how we collect the informations at image and how we set up a project. So first of all, I just need to create a new project. It's a blank project, nothing in it. And I point out we use a wizard to help you organize the information, start from the wells, and then move on to the tools, shots, well logs, and then well objects. And after that, you can start to create stages, and different stages can have different processing properties. So suppose that we have collected everything from the client. So we have the surveys, the sonic logs, the perforation location, and some well object information, formation top, packers, plugs, sleeves, etc. Here just shows you an example of those files. They're relatively clean. You just need four columns for the survey, measured depths, total depths, and also deviation along north and along east and west. So to import them, you just need to tell which columns has which information. So I'm importing survey one, and the fourth column has east, third column is north. It's usually easy to make a mistake that you put north to the east and the east to the north. I know the wellhead location and the coordinate, so I just enter the coordinate for the wellhead. And after you import them, the 3D coordinate for the well survey is automatically generated. And the same thing for the second well. Also, I'm using the second wellhead as the original point, so the wellhead coordinate is zero. We can also add some additional wells if we have, but it's not required to move on to the next step. So we don't have the information, so we move on to the tools. So here, just want to say a few things about adding the tools. Now you have the well deviation surveys, so you don't need the 3D coordinate of the tools, the tool strings. You just need the measure depth and also the orientation of the tools. So the software will slide the tools along the well path and automatically, based on the measure depths, will automatically calculate a northeast and a vertical coordinate for you, as well as the orientation of the tools. And of course, the z-axis is always along the borehole. If it's vertical borehole, z is vertical. If it's horizontal, then z-axis is horizontal. Next is importing the perforation shots. So again, you don't need the 3D coordinate, you just need the measured depths along which well. And then you just put that in the, attach that to the well survey, and the 3D coordinate is calculated. Now I'm importing the sonic logs. So the sonic logs are organized in separate files. So that's the sonic log for P wave, sonic log for shear wave, and also for gamma logs. Gamma log will be useful if you're planning to create some Thomson parameters when there's anisotropies. So that's the picture that they just see is the initial velocities. You have the sonic logs and you have average velocity that's calculated. And you didn't create any layered, you didn't create any layered velocity yet. The next step is weld objects. So you need that information to know where the perforation starts. And in this case, I just organize everything in a single file and I import that weld object into the software. Just to point out, there is a time attribute for this object. So that means if you play the events as a function of time as a movie, the perf locations will appear when it starts in real time. So you can actually use that way. In that way, you can actually understand when which stage start at which time. So here is the final object looks like. I'll continue the video. So we have gamma logs that plotted beside the borehole. We have some plug and sleeves. The rectangles are the formation. So the default size is small because you don't assume it's a whole a layered model, but you can increase the size if you want to, if you believe the geology in that area is relatively flat. So you can increase the bottom formation and the top formation. So basically, based on the geology information, you now have at least the three layered models that you can use when you create your velocity. Now you have everything collected in a project, you can create stages. And different stage can have different geoforms. So it's perfectly okay. One stage moved the observation instrument for different stage. You just need to document that and use the right geoform locations for the right stage. So here I just import the instrument for that stage. And in this example, that for two operation point, we're actually not moving the geoforms. The geoform are stayed in the same position. We can also add the coordinate. So because I know the coordinate of this project, the size of the project, so I just enter the minimum and the maximum coordinate for this project. The depth actually goes all the way down to 12,000 feet. So that's almost 4 kilometers depth. So here we go. We have the project set up and we have the coordinate that's behind it. So that's the typical workflows that we usually go when we set up the project. And the next step is, of course, sending that to client and have it verified before we move on to the next step. The next step is geoform orientation or rotation. Depends on how the known shots or the calibration shot is organized. Sometimes it's organized with the continuous data stream, so you need to trigger the data first before you do the geoform rotation. Sometimes stream shots or surface vibration shots are collected as separate CY files, so you don't need to trigger the data in order to have those known shots, so you can do the geoform rotation before the triggering. So the theory behind the geoform rotation is relatively simple. It relies on Hildebrand analysis. So you start by assuming X and Y axis is known. For example, S pointing to east, Y point to north, and you have a known shots waveform that's recorded. So you can use that orientation to calculate the measured orientation. And of course, the first measured orientation is way off from the true orientation because you assumed X and Y orientation. So what you do next is rotate X and Y about the Z axis and try to minimize the differences between the measured orientation and the true orientation. And once the two vectors are minimized and you get the orientation for that geoform, and we'll repeat that for the rest geoforms. And there's a side note that I want to put in, add is the orientation has two angles. One is the azimuth and one is the plunge or the dipping angle. And this dipping angle is sensitive to the velocity models you're using at this stage. So if you're not sure about the velocity information at this point, you may just consider minimize the differences between the azimuths of these two vectors instead of comparing the 3D vectors in 3D. So here, just quickly touch on the hologram analysis. We covered that actually in the previous webinar, but just to quickly show you the theories behind that. If we have a particle motion coming from left to right, and we have a vertical component and a horizontal component, and of course only the horizontal component will be responsive to that particle, to that motion. And if we plot the horizontal particle motion with the horizontal, vertical, you're going to see a particle motion horizontal. So that is the information indicating the energy is coming from in the lateral direction. You don't know the direction if it's coming from the left or coming from the right. So you lose that direction and you have a 180 degree ambiguity. So you need some additional information to constrain that. If the energy coming from a 45 degree, then you'll have a 45 degree particle motion. If you have noise, then the particle motion are not linear. So you can fit a linear vectors to the particle motion, but that is not 100% accurate. So, and that's so-called the hologram uncertainties there. So the previous webinar, and we have a following webinars that are talking about those uncertainties. So the tips here is when you're doing the geophone orientation and you're deciding, selecting the known shots to do the orientation, make sure you're selecting a good quality data and has a good signal to noise ratio and has an impact to the accuracy. And also when you choose the time window to plot the particle motion, be aware if the window is too large, you're going to include some other wave that is not associated with the phase that you're looking at, and that will introduce a wave interferences. So I just want to quickly touch on this this topic. The next step is data triggering. So just focus on the left part of this picture. It's a kind of a cartoon showing you a typical operation site. So when we inject a fluid into the reservoir or a geothermal site, or injecting a fluid into the rock, and we turn on the geophones either in the borehole or on the surface, it's like you turn on the water tap. It really depends on the acquisition, the number of acquisition instrument or the sampling rate. And sometimes in nowadays, it's more like when you turn on the geophones, it's more like a reservoir discharge of water. It's a huge amount of water, a huge amount of data will flood your hard drive. And what you need to do is you need to run a detector. You run a detector and go through the data streams and look for the triggers, the useful informations through the data streams. And whenever you find a trigger, you can plot them in 3D. It's like a dots in 3D. So there is a trade-off when you're doing that in practice, is the number of triggers and the quality of triggers. If you use a very sensitive detector, you'll get a lot of trigger, and you also, most of them are noise. So there's a trade-off when you do the real-time data processing. So here, again, I'm gonna use a video to demonstrate how we do the detection in a real-time situation. So imagine that this folder, the raw data, is where the energy, the acquisition system dumping files to this folders, maybe 1 second per file, maybe 5 minutes per file, depending on the acquisition type. So as example, I only have 100 files here, but in a real situation, that number will keep increasing. To store the triggers, I create two file folders that I need. It don't have to be on the same computer. You can have two computers side by side to do the triggering and processing at the same time. So here is the project we just set up. I just delete the previous processing results. And before I do the triggering, I just want to show the acquisition geometries for this project. It's the project that we saw before, vertical borehole, and the treatment is here. And then set up the folders where you want to put to save the trigger files. And in terms of size, the triggered files are like 1 gigabyte compared to 1 terabyte of data streams. So it's much smaller in size. You can choose the file format that you're looking at. So in this case, it's MRF. So I just use a MRF data format. And also I ask the software to do automatic processing or whenever he found a trigger. So what I just show here is actually a drop-down window. And the option here is, do you want to save the triggers or just want to scan through the data and get a sense of the number of triggers? And that's applicable when you are not sure if you're using a right triggering parameters, if you're using a sensitive detector or not sensitive detector for this data. So you can actually no waveform storage. You just scan through the data streams and see how many triggers you got and use that information to refine the detector parameters. So in this case, I just make sure I'm using the real full-time operation. That's gonna save every triggers that I found. The detector is the simple one, short time and long time window. turn on the feedback, and then start triggering. So I detected 100 new files. In real situation, those files will keep increasing, and the feedback just tells me where and what time it's been triggered. This is multi-threading, so I can return back to the 3D visualizer, either sit here and watch the events coming, or you can go back to the waveform and start do some quality controls on the process results. The size of the events are in magnitude. The color is in time, so green is early and red are late. And whenever you see a large event, the whole size of the events will shrink because we're using so that they're on the same scale. So up to now we have 36 triggers. You can look at the waveforms you have. I think out of this 100 files, we have about 161 triggers. And out of that, 46 were located automatically. And in this example, because we have no new files coming, so I can turn off the triggering and examine the data. So as you can see, some of the data are located. So it has a check mark. Some of them are not, and consider as located in the wrong location, so they're disabled. So we can quickly scan through the located events here, and you can see they're typical microseismic events. Some of them are a good quality, some of them are not. And even the older peaking is not doing a fine job, as you can see in this example, it's still located. The reason is we have a safety mechanism that built in. So every time we locate events, we'll check the residuals and throw away the one that we consider as an outlier. And then we're going to relocate events again. So in this case, we're going to throw this outlier, this one next, this one. And then after that, the rest of the travel times will still give you the right location of these events. So you can scan through that and to evaluate the performance of the older processor. You can also enable the failed events and look at why it fails. In this case, it's very simple. There's no P wave. So even for a human processor, it's very difficult to decide where is the P wave. But in the real processing, you can quickly come back and add some P wave that you consider there is and relocate events. So once you add the P wave, it's located. And you can try to see what is the event. So I turn on the pulseration so you know where the location is. It's located in the majority of the rest. So it's kind of a quick quality control to make sure that you're located to the right location. Now, if you're doing a post-processing, you can actually fine-tune some processing parameters, either using change the location method, either grid search or some other method. If you want to use a P-wave source vector or you add a shear wave source vector, in some cases, you don't see P-wave at all. And if that's your situation, you probably have to rely on the shear wave and do some fine processings for those events. You can also turn on the parallel processing because now the computer is not doing triggering anymore, so you can focus on the processing and make full use of the processing powers. So here I just look at another failed example. Of course, the reason is the opposite. There's no shear wave. So you can draw a line and guide the software to peak the shear wave, or you just manually add some arrivals that you consider is the shear wave, and you relocate events. It's done, and you look at the locations. It's right there. So they're in the majorities. So you can accept that location, and you can enable all the events, and then do some manual repeakings to correct the arrival time and add. So that you can add more events to your catalog, and that will help the people to do the interpretation afterwards. So that's actually the data detection work that we do at Image, and actually it's only a part of the entire workflow, as you can see here. After the detector, we need to do locations, and that's it's already included in the video. But there are many other detectors that you can choose. You can either use a short time, long time window, as is shown in the example, or you can choose a match filter. So the feature of a match filter is match filter likes signals that likes themselves, right? So if you are expecting some multiplets, you can use a match filter as a template and try to detect weaker events, but have the same or similar waveform to the match filter. After that, you can put them to the waveform preconditioning for to prepare for the location. You can either just use the raw waveform and peak the P wave, or you can transform them to a short time and long time window and automatically peak the P wave and shear wave. The source vector has to be done on the raw waveform, so you can include all of them and use the arrival time inversion to get the location. When the signal quality is not that good, you probably want to consider a scanning or a beam steering or migration or whatever way you call that. You can include the semblance and also the polarity, and then check every single grid point in 3D, and the points that maximize the energy will be the location. So after the location, you can actually feedback to your match filter and use the located events that to detect more events from your data stream. So I'll come back to the data processing and location part later. And the next step actually is a velocity model calibration. So I have a few tips when you do the velocity model calibration. Make sure you choose the good signal to noise ratio data. So it's always the quality of the data matters. And when you build your velocity models based on the sonic log, try to make minimum perturbations, as minimum as possible. And because of the non-uniqueness, you will realize there are more than one velocity models that can match your travel time. So if that's the case, choose the one that's geologically reasonable and don't change the velocity too much. And also, ideally, we would love to have a single velocity model for either one stage project or 100 stage project. But if that's not possible, you could use a velocity model for a group of stages, or even each stage has its own velocity models, if that's your case. So on the right is just a decision tree help you to decide what kind of shots, waveforms that you can use to calibrate your velocity model. If you're completing the well using the perforation shots, then of course use that to calibrate your velocity. If it's a different way of completion, then you may use a ball seat event to do that. If none of them are available, you probably can consider a vibration shot on the surface or some stream shots. If that's not an option as well, then you can use the early events, early microseismic events. So remember, the fracture schedule that you collected from the client now becomes useful. You can look at that and see where to look for the early microseismic events for the stage that I'm working on. But if that is even not available, then you have to only rely on the sonic logs and build a velocity model that's based on that. And again, there will be uncertainties, even you're using perf shots to calibrate your velocities. So as people said, your location is only as accurate as your velocity model. So in the previous webinar, we actually covered the uncertainties that are coming from the velocity model. So I'm not gonna talk about the details here. The point is, if you have some concerns about your velocity and how that will control your location uncertainty, you can do a Monte Carlo simulation to make sure that you understand the impact of that uncertainty on your location. So again, I'm going to use a video to show how we do a velocity calibration at image. So first, we open up the project we just set up. So we have the well, treatment well, observation well, and we have a perforation or known shots right here. So, and that's the calibration shots waveform, very typical and very good signal to noise ratio. And because the waveform, a geophone has been rotated, so the face you're looking at here is actually consistent across the instrument. Now, what we need to do to calibrate the velocity is to build build a velocity model. So here I'm just showing there's no velocity in for this stage yet. So we have to start from scratch. Well, we have sonic logs, so we can at least build velocity model based on that. And there's formation information that from a geology model. So I can turn that on and turn on the geoform. So we can add layers to our model. So basically I add five layers first, and that's the layers that I can call from the velocity model. So I call that initial. And then I can use that velocity model and calculate a theoretical arrivals. So I'm making sure that I'm using the initial velocity model. And then I can calculate the theoretical arrival and compare that with the waveform. To calculate a theoretical arrival, I need to have a user-defined position. in the picture. So I put the user defined position at where I expect to see the perforation shots. So that's the theoretical arrival based on that velocity model. So I can change the initial time and try to match the move out of the theoretical arrival with the waveform. As you can see here, it matches the bottom one, but not the top ones. So what I need to do is I need to manually change the velocity models for that. So the red is P and the green is shear wave. So I'm working on the P wave right now. Just turn on the formation and turn on the geophones. The shot is in this layer. So the bottom two layers actually has no contribution. So I'm not considering that. I'm manually changing the velocity layers, velocity values for each layer. And this is a simple example. We only have one perforation shots, so one stage, so it's relatively easy. But if you have more than one perforation shots, you can use automatic calibration process to do that. And I'll show you how to do that after the manual processing. So it takes a little bit of patience to match the velocity. You also get a sense of which layer is more sensitive and which layer is not. And what I'm trying to do is try to match the layer with the sonic log and don't change that much. And same for the shear wave. So manually adjusting the theoretical arrival actually is updating at the same time. So when I'm happy with the results, I can save that. So I didn't touch the bottom ones. And then for the automatic processing, I need to specify the lower and upper bound. And that's the bound that I'm looking, that I'm perturbing the velocity to look for the global minimums. So for that three layers, I specify the upper and lower bound 500 meters per second. And for the bottom two layers, because I don't expect them to have any contributions, so I make the perturbation in zero. So I don't perturb these two layers. And I save that, so overwrite the previous velocity model. So it's right here. Now I'm going to use that, make sure I'm using the right velocity model. And as a quality check, I just turn on the theoretical arrivals and try to look at the waveform. So it looks much better compared to the previous one. The next step I just show you here is I can use the automatic calibration to fine tune the velocity for each layer. So each layer corresponding to a for loop. So I have three layers that has contribution to the travel time. So I have three for loops here. So the software is doing a global search to look for the velocity values within the boundary that I defined. And that can minimize the differences between the calculated arrival and the observed arrivals. So that's the black dots and the red dot corresponding to. So they match as well. If you look at the velocity values, they're actually slightly different. For some P wave may be different, the same, but shear wave has been changed. So you can save that as your first calibrated velocity model for stage one. And you can change your velocity to the calibrated velocity model. And you can double check if that's all right. So the older processing, the older calibration is doing a fine job here. And then I can turn on the travel time pickings that I picked for these events. So that's the blue and the green ones are the manual picking for P and shear wave. And I can just use that velocity, these shots. And in theory, it should be located to the perforation shots locations. Here is because it's a simple example. So it locate to exactly where it's supposed to be. So it's kind of a quality control step that the velocity calibration is fine. So that's a quick overview of a velocity a model calibration that we do at Image. And after that, we can do the location. The fundamental of location, actually, I mentioned in the first slice. The first constraint coming from the travel time differences between the P wave and the shear wave. If it's close to the shots, arrival time is short. If it's further away from the shots, the difference is large. So that's one constraint from the waveform. The other constraint is the source vector that I'm showing you here. So X and Y are now rotated to its two orientation. So it will give the orientation, give the direction of the events. So if you use more than once, you can actually constrain the region where you expect the source. So you can use either a reverse time method or a migration type of method to locate events. So in general, there are two groups of location method. One group rely on the travel time, and the other group doesn't rely on a group the travel time, the so-called source scanning or bean steering or migration or any other names that you may like. For the time-based location method, we have simplex and giga, and that's just linearized the location. You need to have a starting point, and then you iteratively go to the down, go to the bottom of the valley and look for the local minimum. Grid search doesn't have that local minimum problems. It will just search within the 3D space, and we use an oak tree mesh. So start with a coarse mesh and then refine the mesh around the global minimum each time, each iteration, and gradually reduce increase the resolution till you reach the resolution that you need. The relative location is slightly different from the rest method. It's not locate the absolute location. It's using, for example, the double difference method to locate the relative distance between a master events and the slave events. The theory behind that is for two events that occur very close, their travel time uncertainties will be canceled out because their traveling path is similar. So it can give a relatively high accuracy for the relative distance between the master and the slave events. So all that depends on a travel time picking. The source scanning doesn't depend on the travel time picking, so it's relatively more ultimate. So you can let the software to decide where the location is, but that's all. It doesn't mean it's better than the rest method. So all this method you can consider, there's no the best. It really depends on your project. And based on our experience, we would prefer if you can pick the events, we'll use the travel time method. If you cannot, or for weak events, you probably want to use the source scanning or bean steering method. So before I conclude this presentation, I just want to point out that this is two processing results. That one is using a scanning method that is automated, and this is using the travel time based method. So as you can see here, the final process result, both of them are delivered result to the client. So it's not intermediate results. And you can see based on the processing results, the interpretation of that is almost the opposite. For example, if it's original interpretation, the fracture actually grows to the top and reach a boundary, and that it's not growing, and there's no microseismic events below that. And in the reprocessed events, it does grow to a certain depth, but it grows continuously, and there's no boundaries on the top. The other interpretation, if you look at the map view here, so it looks like the stages has some overlap between each stage. The black ones and the red ones, it looks like they're overlapping the same region. So the interpretation that is the stimulation is not well planned because you have significant overlap, you're wasting the injecting power. But if you're looking at the reprocessed, they're not that significant overlap. There are some overlapping, but they're not significant. And the interpretation is the opposite. Actually, the design is optimum. And also, if you look at the aspect ratio of the cloud, so these are more rounded, and the aspect ratio for that is more large, is larger. So the indication for that is the minimum and maximum stress in this case is different. So I use this example, just want to point out there's no the best techniques, and you have to consider all of them when you are processing your own project. And automation is not really the excuse of not doing a quality control. So we're going to talk about more about arrival time, reprocessing and quality control in the next webinar. So I can conclude this presentation. Project setup and processing are the two fundamental steps in microseismic data processing. The setup step involves a lot of communication with the client, and don't take things for granted, and don't omit that the small details. Do get a verification before you start touching the raw data. And for the harvesting, it's a trade-off between the quality and quantity, the calibration. You need to calibrate both the velocity and the geoform. For the location part, you need to consider all the location algorithms that are available to you. And don't forget the quality control. It's very important. And just want to point out all the processing videos that I show you are using our software Insight. So if you have any questions or interest in any of the any more new functions, you're welcome to contact us by this email. Our next webinar will be in August and focusing on the reprocessing and quality control, still on this part of the workflow. So help you to control the processing quality from anyone who process your data, and you're able to ask the right questions. So please stay tuned for the following webinars. Thank you.